Hi, everybody. This is the Prep Preview Show for prep football games on Wednesday, October 20th and Thursday, October 21st. I'm Randy Shaver, flying solo this week. A short week for all of us. Craig is off, and he'll be working the spotlight game on Wednesday night. We're going to get to that in a second. It's Providence Academy at SMB. Big game for two smaller schools having great seasons, and we're going to talk about that in a minute. In a few minutes, we're going to reveal our all-decade football team from 1987 to 1999. 35 players chosen, some outstanding players from days gone by, and so much fun to put this together, and that's coming up in just a few minutes. All right, let's talk about Wednesday night. It's the last night of the regular season for a vast majority of teams across the state of Minnesota. Our spotlight game is unbeaten Providence Academy, ranked number 5 in 3A, at least heading into the rankings this week, and they're going up against a 4A school in SMB, who's ranked among the top 10 with a record of 5-2. On the surface, you might think that SMB has the advantage, being the bigger school, but both of these teams sport some outstanding talent. On the offensive side for SMB, you got to start with Sanjay Redd, who's had an outstanding year at running back. When he gets into space, he is so hard to bring down. Fast, athletic, has another gear. SMB, more of a running team, and they depend on Redd, and he makes them go. 1,094 yards in 7 games, 14 touchdowns. He's going to give the Lions defense some nightmares on Wednesday night. It's a home game for SMB. On the other side is this guy, Jacob Meisner, who's rushed for 894 yards and 14 touchdowns this year for the undefeated Lions. An impressive player, hard to bring down, 6'2", 210. He plays defense too. He has 16 tackles for losses and 9 sacks. He just does everything for Providence Academy. So when you add in also for SMB, Chase Carter, who's verbally committed to Michigan State, and the big offensive lineman, Peyton Lang, it's going to be quite the game on Wednesday night. I know we show a lot of 6A games during the course of a season, but this is going to be a fun, smaller school matchup, and it's our spotlight game on Wednesday. All right, the playoff seedings meetings will take place for virtually every team in Minnesota either late Wednesday night or Thursday morning, except in 6A. The big schools are playing some games on Thursday night, pushing the seeding meetings to either late Thursday or Friday. So let's talk about these sections, which is crazy because of the division they decided to do this year in dividing 6A teams into a gold division and a maroon division. We're going to start with section number 6. This one, to me, I think Eden Prairie is going to end up as the number one team in the section. Minnetonka's obviously had a great year. It's going to be an interesting discussion if they both end up 7-1, and likely that will happen, although Eden Prairie does play Stillwater on Thursday night, Minnetonka playing at Roseville. So that's going to be an interesting discussion for 1 and 2. Shakopee, of course, is in there battling with Wayzata for that 3 and 4 spot. And then, of course, the only maroon teams in this part is Hopkins and Burnsville. And they are sitting down there at 1 and 6 and 0 and 8. All right, section 5. A little more clear cut. Maple Grove is going to be the number one seed, regardless of what happens this week. The real discussion is going to be between Osseo, St. Michael, and Anoka, because Osseo and Anoka are maroon teams, so they have not played the strength of schedule that St. Michael Albertville has. My guess is that St. Michael likely will be the number two seed, depending on what happens this week. But it's going to be an interesting discussion between those teams. And the bottom half of this is pretty much clear cut with Brainerd and Blaine, Champlin Park still looking for their first win of the year, and Coon Rapids at 1-6. Section 4, Stillwater goes to EP on Thursday night. Likely will lose that football game, but you never know what's going to happen. If they do lose and end up 7-1, and Woodbury wins, well, that's an interesting discussion because Woodbury is playing Centennial on Wednesday night. Now, Woodbury's a maroon, Centennial's a gold. So the gold teams have played arguably tougher schedules, strength of schedules. I don't think there's any dispute about that. So if Centennial were to win, it's clear cut. If Woodbury wins that game, then Stillwater and Woodbury are going to fight it out for the number one number two seeds. And then we'll see what happens to Centennial. White Bear Lake, by the way, also a maroon team sitting at 5-2. Now, Section 3, Lakeville South, by far the easiest one to pick because they're number one, they're undefeated, they're a gold team, they're going to be fine. Again, though, the discussion, look at Farmington Park and Eastridge. Farmington's a gold, so they've played the tougher schedules. Park and Eastridge are both maroons, and so there's going to be a discussion about who's going to be three, who's going to be four. And Rosemount has really kind of fallen off here the last couple of weeks to sit at 3-4, but they're a gold, and so is Lakeville North. And again, the discussions are going to be, we played a tougher schedule than you did. Disregard our overall records, where should we be? And this is what's going to be happening this week for the first time. 6A is going to be full of a lot of maybe possibly contentious seeding meetings this week. Now remember that 6A plays crossover games right away. And that's determined via a blind draw on Friday, which is done by the Minnesota Football Coaches Association in conjunction with the State High School League. So there's a lot of intrigue as to how 6A is going to shake out. They don't open their playoffs until a week from Friday on October 29th. All right, as we head into the final week of the regular season, we continue to talk about the official shortage in Minnesota. It has turned Friday night lights into Thursday games, Saturday games, more than ever before. In fact, the regular season this week will extend into Thursday night for about 14 6A teams. That is unheard of in years past. Usually MEA Wednesday is the cutoff. That's it. You don't play beyond that to allow everybody to have that MEA weekend. Not the case anymore. So that's where we are. And I asked Lakeville South head coach Ben Burke for his thoughts on some solutions.
To me, one of the ways to solve it is to treat those people with kindness and respect that they deserve for their service, right? You got to make it worth their time. If you look at there's a shortage, but a lot of times it has to do with their aging out. And so there's a lot of people who have been serving in that capacity for a long time, and now they're starting to retire because they can't do it. And what's somebody my age gonna do to be a referee? You know, I'm in my 30s. Is that there's not a lot of 30-year-old referees out there, and there needs to be more. And so we've got to find a way to get people that are willing to sacrifice some time. To me, it's about teamwork, you know, and service to your community. That's why I became a teacher. That's why I became a coach, because I get a lot of personal joy out of helping. I think referees a lot of time feel that too. So you have to create an environment where those people are willing to do that, and then reward them. And you know, we got to pay them for their time, and we got to treat them the right way. And hopefully that can result in people wanting to do it more.
And remember, there are no football games without referees. So this is a problem that needs to get solved between the high school league, the schools, and likely the Minnesota Football Coaches Association as well. All right, here's some key games on Wednesday night. Centennial, Woodbury, Moorhead, and Rogers, both ranked in the top 10 in 5A. Big game in Rogers. Armstrong coming off a tough loss, taking on Spring Lake Park, who's back on a roll. Those two teams are among the better teams in 5A. St. Louis Park, with the incredible comeback win over Waconia last week, go to Chaska, who's undefeated in 5A. And of course, the Pumpkin Bowl is Wednesday night, the last night of the regular season for Anoka at home. It's always the Pumpkin Bowl. They've been doing this since 1948. They'll take on Champlin Park on Wednesday night.
Hot Highlights is sponsored by TrueStone Financial.
As you likely know, this is a short week for voting for Hot Highlights. We have until Wednesday at 2 o'clock. Here they are. One is a catch by Nick Katona for Shakopee. Great catch against Lakeville South. Concentration, comes down with the ball. That's Hot Highlight number one. Fantastic. The hook and ladder is Hot Highlight number two, coming from Prior Lake. Joey Krause off the lateral, beating Rosemount on the last play of the game. That is Hot Highlight number two. It's a fabulous play, and guess what? You're going to see it again, done by another team. The exact same hook and ladder. Farmington and Ben Biskins off the lateral, scoring on the last play of the game against Lakeville North. They would add the two-point conversion to win that game. That is Hot Highlight number three. Go to KARE 11's Facebook page. Vote for your favorite. Once again, the voting will last through Wednesday at 2 o'clock. and I'll announce the winner during the Prep Sports Extra this Wednesday night at 10:20 on KARE. All right. I started naming all Metro football teams on KARE TV in 1987, and I've kept the list of each team each year. Now we name an all-decade team. We have named an all-decade team, I should say, from 2010 to 2019, after the 2019 season. And you can find that on our KARE YouTube page. What we're going to do now is go all the way back, deep in the archives, for our all-decade team from 1987 to 1999. 35 players make this team. Trust me, many great players did not. Can't fit them all on this team. And there were plenty, trust me. But what you're going to see on this video are the players that we name. You're going to see on the corner of the screen, you're going to see their name, their position, and the years that they were named All-Metro by us for KARE TV. So let's start with the offense. And here's Chris Walsh. You remember him? 1991. His older brother Steve was the great player that went to the NFL. Chris was the National Gatorade Player of the Year his senior year. 43 career touchdown passes, 4,343 yards. Amazing. Well, Chris Winkie. You can't have a team without him. 1989. Fabulous arm, great baseball player. Played pro baseball before going back to college and playing for Florida State and Bobby Bowden, winning the Heisman Trophy, later played in the NFL. Ryan Keating, four-year starter at Minnetonka, two-time All-Metro quarterback, threw for 7,482 yards in an amazing career, holds all sorts of records at Minnetonka, played at St. John's and won a D3 title. Running back, Marvin Sims. He was the Parade Magazine All-American 1990, 1991, 2 years he made our team. Fast, shifty, strong. Played for those great Apple Valley teams under Paul Miller. Played at Nebraska in college. Very hard to tackle. How about the Mud Bowl game? Carl McCullough. This is Carl. He played for Creighton Durham Hall. How about this game? Look at the video here. This is the Mud Bowl against Moundsview. Tough runner, big, fast, strong. But you know what? When you got him on the turf, when he played at the Metrodome, you could see the speed because he would break loose and nobody could catch him. He played his college football at Wisconsin, dabbled a little bit in the NFL, dangerous player. You know, St. Paul Johnson had a couple of running backs during the 90s who were tremendous. One of them was Tommy Reynolds, one of the first of two great backs for Jeff Plaschko, the coach at Johnson. Fast, elusive, great vision. Arguably the St. Paul City, not very strong competition-wise, but he proved himself every Friday night. He was the Metro Player of the Year in 1993. So Tommy Reynolds makes our team. We're going to show you the other Johnson back in a second, but first let's go to Stillwater. How about this guy, Aaron Runk? Two-time All-Metro, 94, 95, played that veer offense running back for the great George Thole. Big back, strong, sneaky fast, great leader. The Thole teams were loaded with this kind of player. They won the state title back in 1995. And then, here's the back. Maybe the best back I've seen in Minnesota ever. Thomas Tepe, St. Paul Johnson. All-Metro, 97, 98. This is the iconic run at the Metrodome that, for me, typifies what Thomas Tepe was all about. He had sneaky speed, great moves, super strong, powerful back, and great vision. You may remember he played for the Gophers, was an outstanding player for the Gophers, also played in the NFL, drafted by the Eagles, a fabulous football player. All right, let's go to the receiver position. Skip Schaefbauer, Elk River. Two-time All-Metro, 91-92, was also Mr. Basketball in 93. Played college basketball, actually, but man, was he a good receiver. Two-time All-State football player, outstanding hands, quick, smart player, just fun to watch. Skip Schaefbauer. Elk River had two receivers in the 90s. They don't throw the ball very much anymore, but they did back then. How about Paul Martin? Yeah, as a sophomore in 97, and a senior in 99, was named All-Metro. Of course, he was Minnesota's Mr. Hockey in 2000, played in the NHL for many years as a great defenseman, but He was one of the best receivers I've ever seen. That guy, and along with this guy, Larry Fitzgerald. 1999, his junior year at Holy Angels. You could already see the greatness. He was fantastic. Ended up playing college ball at Pitt, and then, of course, had the Hall of Fame career in the NFL. And you'll probably see him in the 2000 to 2009 All-Decade Team. Tight end, Ben Joppru, Minnetonka. Great hands, very strong. Played with Keating at Tonka. Standout college player at Michigan. Second-round draft choice by the Texans. Mark Lavore, big tight end for Eden Prairie. Soft hands, great blocker. Was All-Metro in 99. Played for Mike Grant, played for Notre Dame, and then played a little bit in the NFL at tackle. Marcus Harris, one of our athletes, Brooklyn Center, 1992. You want to talk about a great all-around player? Went to Wyoming, University of Wyoming, converted to receiver, won the Fred Biletnikoff Award as the best receiver in the nation. Quite the player back in the day for the Centaurs. And then the other athlete? This guy, Adam Gerlach out of Hastings, two-time All-Metro, 98-99, played for Bob Majeski. He did everything, never left the field. Also was a great hockey player, played at Minnesota State Mankato. So he was just an outstanding athlete all the way around for the Hastings Raiders. Here he is making a tackle right here. So those are our two athletes. Let's go to offensive line. Rod Carey was the center for Wyzetta in 98. Dominant player, later played at Indiana, and right now is a Division I football coach at Temple. He's a great, great coach. Mike Doughty, two-time All-Metro from Lakeville. Intimidating. Helped win a state title in 92 under Larry Thompson. Played at Notre Dame, played in the NFL. Just an all-around great player. He was 6'7". Back in the day, I'm telling you, he was the man on the offensive line. How about Dave Butler at Anoka? Two-time All-Metro, 94, 95, All-State both those years. Great player for those Tornado teams that ran the football effectively. He was strong, aggressive, great leader on offense. Dave Butler, who is just a fan. Here you see the kickout block here. Just a great player. How about the Sederstrom boys? And we'll probably hear from Mark in the when we name the 2000 to 2019. Team. But Chad at Northfield, great football player. Here he is, a pancake block. He played at Northern Iowa, short time in the NFL, outstanding player for the Northfield team. And then Ryan Melander of Creighton-Durham Hall, 6'7", 290. This is back in the day now, okay? Pancaked his opponents in 99. Won a state title in 99, played for the Gophers, outstanding player. Let's go kickers. Mike Chalberg, remember him? All-Metro in 90. 10 field goals made in 1990, including a 54-yarder he kicked for the Gophers. And then Dan Nystrom, 97 and 98 from Cooper, once made a 52-yard field goal for Cooper. He kicked 4 years for the Gophers as well. Just a fabulous player. Let's go defense. Jason DeVries, Forest Lake, All-Metro, 91-92. He was also an outstanding wrestler for Bob Detmer at Forest Lake, and he ended up wrestling for Indiana University. And guess what? He's now a doctor here in Minnesota. He's number 70. John Schlecht, great defensive tackle for White Bear Lake back in 95. Later played football for the Gophers, briefly in the NFL. Here he is, big tackle, tough player. Nate Dwyer. Two-time All-Metro, 95-96. Man, was he a dominant force for George Thole's defense. Played college football at Kansas, later drafted in the NFL. He was mean, he was nasty. Great defensive player for the Stillwater Ponies back in their heyday. And then Derek Robinson for De La Salle. He was All-Metro in 1999 at 6'4", 295. Quick, strong, smart. Great Islander teams back in those days. He played his college ball at Iowa, played in the NFL for 5 years. He was quite the force. How about Joe Dziedzic at linebacker? Joe Dziedzic played at Edison High in 1989. Freak of nature, big, strong, gifted, great hockey player, drafted in the NHL in 1990, played for the Gophers as well. Happy Chikolas. This was the first original tackle machine in Minnesota. Metro, All-Metro in 91 and 92, five-sport letterman at North. Happy Chicolas was an amazing high school athlete, undersized, but big heart and great talent. Paul Cradaville, New Prague, two-time All-Metro, 91-92. He made it in two different positions. He made it as a tight end, and then he made it as a linebacker. Was a great athlete, a big guy, very tough, played for the Gophers for a couple of years. He was All-State in 1992. Here he is making a tackle in a game right there. This is back in the day when they played Lakeville on a regular basis. And then Phil Archer, Creighton-Durham Hall, outstanding linebacker, punishing tackler, part of those great Raider teams, All-Metro in 98, played for the Gophers. He's now the athletics director at Creighton. Fabulous football player. The Rosga, Steve Rosga, two-time All-Metro, 90-91. The unbelievable punt return in the Metrodome. He played his college football at Colorado. He was a sensational two-way player for Creighton. His other brother, Tim, also makes the team. Two-time All-Metro. They all wore the same number, 93-94. There were three brothers, by the way. Jeff was also a great football player for Creighton. But Tim later played his college ball at Wisconsin and was a standout special teams player. Here he is making the interception. Just a great guy. Ryan Iverson, Eden Prairie. Watch the incredible interception. Two-time All-Metro, 96-97. Won back-to-back state titles. AP Player of the Year in 97, great basketball player, maybe the first outstanding player under Mike Grant. Adam Larson, tremendous interception here. Played for Eastview, two-time All-Metro, 98-99. Was also a great hockey player. Went to Air Force and played hockey, but a dominant football player back in the day. And then finally, Dominique Sims, De La Salle. All-around fantastic player. All-Metro in 98. All-Metro in 99, USA Today First Team All-American in 99, AP Player of the Year, played his college ball for the Gophers, and remember, he was just an outstanding player for a great De La Salle team back in the day. Those are our 35 players that made our all-decade team from 1987 to 1999. It was fun to dig up this video and to look back. And you can catch this again on our YouTube page. We're going to put it on there, not with my conversation, but with just music so that you can watch it again anytime that you want. But my thanks to all the people that helped us put that together. Our plan is to put together the decade team from 2000 to 2009. And we hope to do that at some point, maybe at the end of this season or at the beginning of next year. So something to look forward to. All right, that's it for the show. Thanks for watching. Wednesday and Thursday, high school football this week. We have a Prep Sports Extra Wednesday night, 10:15 on KARE, 11 o'clock on cable, YouTube, Facebook, KARE11.com. And then Craig and I are back a week from Wednesday on October 27th after round one of the playoffs to look ahead to the rest of the postseason, and we'll see you then. Thanks.